Going into a structure fire is like taking away all of your senses.
A fire has broken out at the historic Notre Dame Cathedral.
You can't see anything, literally, your hand in front of your face.
We've now got around 100 firefighters trying to put this blaze out.
The hardest part for us is not seeing, and now we have eyes on the ground, and we have eyes from above.
You can see a great amount of flames behind here.
When disaster strikes, we rely on first responders to rush in to save lives and property.
Today, the full scale of the destruction in Mexico City has been revealed.
These environments are beyond dangerous, and there are only so many first responders available for any disaster.
And the flooding here is getting worse after waters from Lake Pontchartrain broke through a levee.
Now, robots are joining the battle, throwing their metal and plastic bodies into harm's way to help save human lives. These are the rescue bots. Welcome to Uprising. Fear not. The robots are already here.
Back in the day, this job was a lot more blue collar. It was a heavy use of saws, axes, ladders, and hose. And that was the basic tools of every firefighter. Low technology, just put a hose in your hand and you go in and you fight the fire. To be honest, it started out as pretty much a hobby. I saw a camera in the air and it was remote control, and you know, I'm kind of a tech nerd, so I picked one up and I'd bring it into work and we would use it as a training tool to be able to get an aerial view of things that we were doing. From there, it kind of morphed into, well, what if we used it on structure fire? All right, coming up. Then what if we used them on rescue incidents? To where it is now, pretty much we will use it on almost any kind of incident that isn't an EMS call. As an incident commander, all of our decisions we're usually making off of what we get on the radio. Now I get to see the smoke condition, and being able to read smoke from the drone is just a huge tactical advantage.
Putting out a fire is only one aspect of a fire operation. Understanding the scope of the fire, where the other first responders are situated, and even where to park all the vehicles are all essential aspects of fighting fires. The Fremont Fire Department has partnered with local police to help them track criminals or search for missing persons, often by using the drone's infrared capabilities.
Fremont police use special technology to help find a missing East Bay student.
Police and fire departments are experimenting with all the ways in which drones might be useful, including in water rescues and recoveries.
Here we've had multiple vehicles into the water, and anytime the water gets that high, it becomes extremely dangerous. So now we can put up a drone, do a search without ever having to put people in the water.
Le toit de Notre-Dame est en flammes et la flèche de la cathédrale vient de s'effondrer.
That fire in Notre-Dame, that was the first time I've seen that robot in use. And without that, I don't think they would have been able to save the primary portion of that structure. I think that robotics in itself is definitely the future of firefighting.
At Virginia Tech, Alexander Leonessa and his students developed a firefighting robot to compete in a DARPA robotics challenge.
In this case, a Thor was designed to navigate through a ship, find a fire using a whole suite of sensors from infrared cameras, thermal sensors to actually find the fire, then recognize a hose, grab the hose and extinguish the fire. Ships are a difficult environment to navigate. There are pretty steep steps, there are doors to open. So the idea of having a humanoid robot is that it can navigate through the same kind of environment that was designed for humans, but without risking anybody's life. Now, the question always that as roboticists we need to ask ourselves is the humanoid the best one to reach those environments?
The name of my lab is the Biorobotics Lab. The name biorobotics comes from the fact that a lot of robots we work on have this inspiration from biology. the animal kingdom is full of non-human animals that have been quite successful doing tasks that we can't. For example, a snake can thread through a tightly packed volume and get to places that we can't. One of my favorite applications is to assist rescue workers. As the robot goes through the collapsed rubble, it can do it without disturbing its surroundings. This is of critical importance because the collapsed rubble is likely to be unstable. So one can envision a scenario where the rescue worker moves as forward as possible into the rubble pile, then because of whatever mobility challenges, drops a control case that steers the snake robot and then drives the snake robot beyond his particular reach. Right now, it's usually two operators and a tether handler handling one robot. That ratio is wrong. I envision a future where one operator will be able to control 5, perhaps 20 robots at once. But I think it's a little bit more exciting than that. I believe that as each of these robots move through the rubble, they'll be able to use modern machine learning techniques to learn from those experiences, and they'll be able to share their experiences. So when one robot learns from its experience, all the robots can learn. I'm sad to say we're not working as hard as we could be or should be on this problem. Response for robots is not the most well-funded activity because people only care about it the day after the disaster, and then a week or so afterwards, they forgot all about it.
Technology for first responders has been accelerated by the consumer goods industry and academia. But with success stories like the Fremont Fire Department, the adoption and development of new tools are increasing.
3 years ago, when we first officially went live on our program, we were one of only three departments in the state that were doing it. Until we went out and we flew on a couple of incidents, they just thought we were out there flying and playing with their toys. Now, everybody wants to be part of the program. You know, they're asking for them on different incidents. In 10 years from now, I think every fire department, police department across the nation will either have drones or will be looking to get drones. Now, this technology provides us a level of safety for our crews that hasn't been seen before. If we can keep somebody from losing their life with the use of technology, why would we not do it?
Thanks for watching this episode of Uprising. Please like and subscribe. It really helps us grow our channel and tell more stories about people who are thinking differently and changing the world.